Amen, church. Can we all stand? Of Jesus, so often we quote it and we forget what it means, but he says, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, all you who are burdened, and I will give you rest. I will give you rest. Every weight, every fear, every anxiety, every anger and bitter thing, everything that's weighing your heart down, he says, come to me and I'll give you rest instead. I don't know about you in this room, but I want to trade my sorrows, my pains, my anxieties, any bitterness, anything that's not like Christ, and I want to trade it for his rest. I want to trade it for the rest that comes from knowing him, the peace that passes all understanding. For him who is our peace, like the Bible says. Church, let's trade it tonight. Let's lay it all at the foot of the cross and trade it for him who is our peace. The Bible says the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So let's give it to him tonight. Would you bow your heads with me? Hallelujah, Lord. God, we're not looking. We say it so often, oh God, here. But we want to tell you again and again and again. We're not here to have a service. We're not looking to have a service. We're here to be changed by the living God. We're here to be touched and moved and transformed by the living God. We're here, Lord Jesus, because we know you answer prayer. We're here, oh God, because we know you're faithful. And that when we call on your name, oh God, you move, Lord. Father, would you increase our faith tonight? Increase our faith. Your word says, whoever comes to you must believe that you exist and that you reward those who diligently seek you. And Father God, we declare to you that we believe tonight. But Lord Jesus, we also have a flesh, Lord. Would you help us overcome any area of unbelief in our lives, oh God? Help us to put our trust fully in you, our hope fully in you, our belief, our faith, everything in you, Jesus. Don't let us have any unbelief or doubt anymore. But Father God, put all of that aside. Your word says, come to me with those things, and instead I will give you rest. I will give you rest for your soul. Father God, give us rest tonight for our souls, oh Lord. God, don't let us leave this place until you've satisfied our spirits and our hearts that long for you, that look for you, Lord. May we not be in a rush to leave you or leave your presence, Father, because it's in your presence that we're changed. Lord, we're asking for a mighty move of your Holy Spirit tonight, and we ask that you would do it according to your will and plan. Anoint the word as it goes forth, oh God, today. Anoint Joey, oh God. He's going to bring the word, your word. Speak through him. May your hand cover him, oh God. May your word come out from him like a fire shut up in his bones, oh God, we pray. And we ask, oh God, that in this entire meeting, God, that you would increase our faith and that you would meet with us like you've never met with us before. Do a new work today. A new work, oh God. And transform us, transform our minds, transform our hearts, our will, oh God. Point us to you, we pray. And may we be satisfied with nothing less than all of you. We love you, Lord, and we ask and declare all of these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen, church. Let's worship him tonight. Amen. Thank you. Your name, oh God, hallelujah. We glorify your holy name, oh Lord.
Spirit is moving in the sanctuary. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, we wait upon the ministry of the Lord. Hallelujah. We need a fresh anointing from you, oh God. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, we need you, Father, like never before.
Your faithfulness, faithfulness.
Sets the course of all things, Lord God. A star does not fall from heaven that you do not know about, Lord Jesus. Lord God, a grain of sand, Lord Jesus, cannot be added, Lord God, to the seashore that you do not know about, Lord Jesus. All things are directed by the word of the Lord, Lord Jesus. So, Lord Jesus, we know, Lord God, with surety, Lord God, that our Father's promise still stands, Lord Jesus. And you have never failed us, Lord. You are more than a conqueror, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, you are a mighty warrior, Lord God. And because you have conquered, Lord God, your people, Lord Jesus, have conquered as well, Lord.
you're faithful, and I'm holding on to the love that has laid hold of me. I'm holding on to the love that has laid hold of me. I'm holding on to the love that has laid hold of me. I'm holding on to the love that has laid hold of me.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 You know, I just sense in my spirit that the Lord wants many here to do just that. Lay hold of the love that Jesus has for you. Your soul longs for that love. My soul longs for that love. And I'm going to ask you just to lift your hands. Lift your hands. And begin to receive the love of God. The presence of God is here. He is love. Love not only comes from Him, but He is love. Begin to receive the love of God. Begin to cry out to God. Just reach out to Him. He wants to minister to you tonight. He wants you to experience His love. Oh, saints, when you experience His love, the world looks totally different. Your problems look totally different. Your situation looks totally different. God wants you to experience His love, not just read about it and know about it. He wants to bathe you in His love and surround you today. Oh, whatever is bothering you today, whatever is troubling you today, whatever's weighing you down, would you right now just lift that up to the Lord and receive His love in exchange? Oh God, do a work in your people. Oh God, pour out your Holy Spirit. Oh God, pour out your love. Oh Lord Jesus, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh God, we glorify your name, Lord. We glorify your name, Lord God. How we need your love, oh God, how we need your love. We were created, oh God, Lord, to, Lord God, be in you, Lord God, and experience your love, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Our hearts are open tonight, oh God. God, show us, oh God, Lord, whatever barriers there are, oh God, that's stopping anyone, oh Lord God, from, Lord Jesus, from receiving your Holy Spirit, oh God, and being filled, oh God, with your presence, oh God, and experience your love. I pray, Father, that you would remove any barrier or obstacle, oh God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, that you want to minister to your people tonight, oh God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We receive from you tonight, Lord Jesus. God, minister to every heart, oh God. Lord, what's wonderful about you is that you know what every single heart here contains and what every single person is experiencing and going through, and you're concerned about it, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, what a God we serve. What a God we serve, Lord. We are humbled and we are awed by you, Lord Jesus. Lord, we didn't come here for anything else, Lord. We came here to meet with you, Lord God, to have our spirit connect with your spirit, oh God. Lord, to be renewed and refreshed and restored, hallelujah. To have our hope, oh God, Lord, refreshed, Lord God, so that it won't grow stale, oh Lord God. Hallelujah. We love you, Lord, with all of our hearts. We love you, Lord. And we thank you, Lord Jesus. Continue, Father, to be with us. Continue to manifest your presence, Lord God, as we wait on you, Lord God. We wait on you, Lord God. Hallelujah. We love you, Lord, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. And the people of God said, amen, amen. You may be seated. You know, I was thinking a lot of our issues and complaints and whatnot are solved by God's love. And that's what we need. You just need a dose of God's love to get us straight. How many say amen? Amen. Just want to let you know of a few things. Tomorrow evening at 7 p.m. is our prayer call. Those of you that can join to pray for each other's needs and also for the needs of the church, the needs of the nation and around the world, we invite you to join the prayer call at 7 p.m. That number is on all of our social media, and I believe it might be up there on the screen for you as well. Also, this Friday, the young adults get back together here at 7:30. They did a kind of combined in-person Zoom meeting last time, and quite a few people joined in through Zoom, and there were folks here as well. We're going to try to make that even a better experience this Friday. So we invite every young adult who's hungry for more of God and for his word to join at 7:30 here or through Zoom. The link will be on our social media website, Facebook page, Instagram. Don't miss that. And then also want to let you know about a very special Sunday. We've been announcing it for about a month now. A very, very dear friend, Jamie George, a violinist, an anointed violinist. You've never heard songs and hymns, someone playing a violin anointed in this way. You will be very, very blessed. We are going to have him for our service. He's going to play special music just to give you a little taste. And then we're going to have some kind of something for you to eat in the meantime so you don't have to go. Because at 3 p.m. he's going to give a full concert. It's no charge. It's a free concert. And we want everybody to enjoy that. That's this Sunday at 3 p.m. He'll also be with us for our Sunday service. Right now, I'm going to get ready to pray for the offering. Those of you that are here, you can get prepared to give. Those of you at home, you can give by either mailing a check to Deep Waters Tabernacle, 9861 Old National Pike, Guynesville, Maryland, 21754, or going on our website, deepwaterstabernacle.org, and going to the right top hand, right corner in the giving button, and if you press on that, it'll walk you through some very easy and secure steps so that you can give your tithes and offerings. Would you bow your heads with me as we pray together? Father, we thank you for your sweet presence here. Lord God, you have our attention. Lord God and Lord, we're humbled by the fact that your word says that your ear is inclined to us, is inclined to our prayers. Oh God, that humbles us. And right now, Father, we want to bless you in our giving, Lord God. We want to worship you in our giving. And we ask, oh God, that as we take this offering, Lord God, you would bless every gift, every giver. Multiply it, Lord God. Bless, Lord God, those especially that can't participate, Lord God, because there's something going on, Lord. I pray, Father, for your blessing and for your supply, oh Lord God, a double blessing for those, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Ushers, you may come and collect our tithes and offerings. I've asked my son Joey to come. He has a word, I believe, for the church today. So would you join me in welcoming Joey Vasquez?
Amen. How's everyone doing this evening? Is it doing okay? Long day of work? You know, Tuesday night prayer meeting is something that that me and my family have been conditioned to doing for a long time. And when I was a child and we would go, I never really quite understood why we would go, because to me they always seemed like the longest. But as I get older, I realize that, you know what, the weaker I get in my body as I grow older, the more I come alive when I'm in the Lord's presence and I don't want to leave. There is no greater minister than our Lord Jesus Christ. So to be in an environment where his spirit is directly ministering to you, that to me is the most precious thing about what we believe as followers of Christ, that he ministers directly to you. And when my father asked me to speak, the Lord had put something on my heart a couple of weeks ago, something that he's been stirring in me over the case of this pandemic. Because I think we can all agree as followers of Christ that our faith has been put through fire through this whole thing. For the young adults that are here, you guys know that I've said this quite often, that everything that we've been taught from grade school up till now, for those of us who have been in the church for a long time, even for those who are new to the faith, all of what we've been learning as followers of Christ has now been put to the test. It's no longer theory. It's something that we actually had to abide by to get through this very dark season in world history. And now, when I see everything that is going on in the world today, the first thing that comes to my mind is, well, the faith that we've been taught, that this kind of glossing over of Christianity, the superficial faith, is it enough to get us through this something as terrible as what we've been experiencing in the world today? Lockdowns, and infringement on our liberties, what will be able to sustain us through this? And here's what I've come to conclude. The superficial faith that many of us have been exposed to for a long time was tested and was broken. So what is the purpose of our faith as followers of Christ going forward? The title of this message is called "The Violent Will Take It by Force." And I'm going to begin by reading to you Matthew 11, beginning in the 7th verse through verse 12. As they departed, Jesus began to say to the multitudes concerning John the Baptist, "What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind? But what did you go out to see? A man clothed in soft garments? Indeed, those who wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. But what do you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I say to you, and more than a prophet. For this is he of whom it is written, 'Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you.' Assuredly, I say to you, among those born of women, there has not risen one greater than John the Baptist. But he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force." Here's the first point I'll leave you with today. Only the violent will claim the kingdom of God. What do I mean by that? This doesn't mean physical violence. It pertains to a spiritual dynamic of what we believe as followers of Christ. As we can see now, what we're seeing in the world today, when you turn on the news and you see all the stuff that is happening, whether it be here in the United States or across the sea into Europe and into Asia, we are witnessing spiritual warfare bleeding out into the physical realm. That's how severe the situation is for us who are followers of Christ living in this world. It is talked about in Scripture that we would be enduring these kinds of things. As the world continues to descend into darkness, our faith will be tried and tested by fire. It's a spiritual war. You know, I've asked the young adults this too. You know, we talk about spiritual warfare and how we fight in the spirit through prayer, correct? This is what we're taught to do. But I don't think we as followers of Christ, especially in today's, really grasp the severity of what goes on in the spiritual realm when we're praying. And I believe it is a grace that the Lord has given us that we're not looking into the spiritual realm to see what is going on. I believe that we couldn't handle it. If the veil was torn back and we were to look through the physical realm into the spiritual and see the darkness behind everything that you're seeing going on in the world today, I am absolutely sure that all of us would fall on our face and collapse. That's how severe. You know, if you look in the 20th century, you know, I love history. You know, my dad will tell you, I love to study history. I love to talk about history. If you look at the 20th century, it's considered to be the bloodiest century in the history of the world. Whether you look at World War II, World War I, Vietnam, Korean War, and all these things, you see images of the most terrible things. Terrible images known to man. The Holocaust, the same thing. You witness these terrible things that just give you a twinge of fear. Well, imagine if you were to look in the spiritual realm behind all of that. I guarantee you it's worse. And I believe that what God did was shield us from witnessing all of that. But he commands us to pray. Because when we pray, it causes all sorts of things to happen in the spiritual realm. The enemy is terrified most when the people of God decide to pray. Because it calls upon the forces of Almighty God himself. We are fighting a war that is fought with a particular weaponry. Again, it's not physical violence. Listen to me, church. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4, and the reading out of the NIV. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. Think about it. And it's not just the spiritual. We witness it back in the Old Testament when Joshua and the people of Israel marched around Jericho. All they needed to do was shout praise unto God, and the wall came crashing down. That's how powerful the force of prayer is. Imagine in the spiritual realm. When you pray and the gates of hell are shook because the people of God are uniting together in one spirit and in one accord to call upon the name of Jesus. It's powerful. The demolishing of strongholds can only be accomplished through prayer. It's this army of strongholds that prevent us from claiming the kingdom of God. What did Jesus mean by the kingdom of heaven suffers violence and the violent take it by force? I'll tell you what it means right now to sum up. It means those who violently pray are the ones who claim the kingdom of God. Amen. Who do warfare in the spirit. If you read throughout the history of the Old Testament or the New Testament, going into the days of the early church was potent and feared by the kingdoms of the world because they prayed with power and authority. It didn't just affect the spiritual world, it crippled the governments of the world. But yet the more that they tried to snuff out what we believe as followers of Christ, the more that the word of God spread throughout the four corners of the world, as Jesus said it would. You didn't need lights, you didn't need a preacher bellowing from a pulpit, all you needed was people who were deciding to pray in one accord. The followers of Christ are not passive, nor were they ever intended to be. But that's exactly what we've become. Jesus' words are an indictment against what we've become today. The pandemic brought the feebleness of our faith to full froth. We witnessed the feebleness of everything that we've been taught about the theory, the books, the tapes. All of it was tried and tested, and it was burned to a crisp. Let me give you some evidence of this. It was a survey that was done. Me and my dad had talked about it. A good number of pastors right now, as soon as this pandemic is over and the lockdowns lift, what is it, Dad, like 20%? 20% of all pastors are leaving the ministry in the United States. 20%. So what was the purpose of everything that they had been teaching their flocks for so long? Here is where the faith mattered most. And where did it go? Where did the faith go? Where did the superficial faith go? It disappeared into nothingness. Jesus himself stated in Matthew 11:16, "But to what shall I liken this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to their companions." What an indictment against us as followers of Christ. "What shall I liken this generation," says our Lord, "to like little children?" When God called us to be warriors for the sake of Christ, you are still being compared to children, to craving spiritual milk. When we should be eating solid food, we should be advanced already. We should be the ones that are telling the world, "Hey, you're in disarray, you're in chaos. We have the answer. His name is Jesus Christ." I'm going to be blunt. Christians today have taken up the causes of a fallen world. While the temple has become infested with hell's thieves looking to steal the kingdom from us, and we've fallen into ruins. The enemy is stealing our temples right from under our noses, and we have been blinded to it. We've been blinded to it. We focus on trying to perfect a fallen world. Let me tell you something. As scripture says, it's not going to be perfect. It's going to get worse. But while we're busy trying to perfect this world, we left the temples of our hearts where the Holy Spirit dwells. We left that in ruins. What did we have to rely on when we could not meet together as the body of Christ? It's a stipulation of scripture. Let us not forsake the meeting of the saints. But we couldn't meet together. So what did we have to rely on? My dad will be the first one to tell you, don't rely on him. Don't rely upon him. Don't live out your faith vicariously through him. He'll be the first one to tell you that. Why? Because in moments like this, when we thought that our liberties and our freedoms were secure, now it's up in the air. We have no idea. So let's say we go into lockdown again. What's going to sustain you? It's not going to be my father. It's going to be the word of God. It's going to be your time with the Lord. It's going to be your time storming heaven. That is the only way that's going to get you through in these days of trial and tribulation. Am I right? The world is crying out for a Savior, and we have him. But if we're busy trying to perfect a fallen world, if we're too busy falling for the enemy's trap, how in the world can we introduce him? We look like hypocrites. We rely on the forces of this world. But instead of relying upon Christ, he is the only hope that the world has left. He's the only hope of the world. The second point I'll leave you with today. Only the violent in faith will be consumed by zeal for their father's house. Again, a little bit of a mystery. Well, let's unpack this point for a minute. In John chapter 2, beginning in verse 13 through 17, going through to 17. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all of them from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market." And his disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." Why did Jesus turn to the dove, to the people who were selling the doves? Because the dove represented the gift of the Holy Spirit that he was going to dispatch once he ascended to the right hand of the Father. Faith is not for sale. Stop turning my father's house into a market. The Holy Spirit is going to be a free gift to anyone who believes in me and calls on my name. I will give them my Holy Spirit. Amen. That's not something to be sold or peddled like candy at a candy store. It is powerful. It is God himself. Amen. The gift of the Holy Spirit is the most amazing thing that we have, because we who are corrupted by sin have been given it out
holy place, the place where the Israelites and people like Moses and Aaron and then Solomon, when they would go into the temple and the glory of the Lord filled them, they overwhelmed them. Well, that same power, that same force, that same God who did miraculous wonders in front of the people of Israel, that same God now lives in you. Your heart has become the most holy place where the Spirit of the Lord dwells. Jesus was illustrating the zeal his followers must have for the temple of God. Let me tell you something. The scene of Jesus overturning tables in the marketplace, it's interesting because we don't really picture Jesus that way. Many people try to treat that incident in isolation. I went to school. I went to college. I took a class on religion, and I wanted to see how the world was teaching incidents like this. Oh, forget it. I mean, the way they mirrored things, they made it look like the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, were trying to correct each other. And when Mark, considered to be the first book that was of the four, had written the story about Jesus in the marketplace, a theory was that the book of Matthew was trying to make Jesus seem less revolutionary, so he was trying to tone down Mark's rhetoric. That's the way the world thinks about that incident. Trying to make Jesus more presentable, because Mark was too raw in his description of what Jesus did in the temple. That's the way the scholars think. But let me tell you something, church. Jesus was not doing, this wasn't just some random event that Jesus was doing. It wasn't just some sporadic thing that Jesus was just filled with righteous anger and going into just overturned tables. He was giving us an example. What was that example? With the same zeal that he defended the temple of his God and the most holy place from the thieves that have set up themselves in there to start stealing from people, who are entering the temple, the same way we must be zealous over the temple that lives within our hearts. And anything that sets itself up that stands against the knowledge of God must be cast out the way Jesus cast out all those money traders and the people who were selling doves. We must be just as zealous. We must be just as zealous. That's, Jesus was illustrating what his followers had to be. This is the purpose of a violent faith. You must be zealous over the temple. Guard it. Think about the stipulations that Moses had given in the first five books of the Bible and in the Torah for how the priests were supposed to conduct themselves in the temple. It was so delicate because he knew what they were dealing with. They were dealing with the raw power of Almighty God himself. Why do we get so careless when that same power lives within us? Are we not called to the same stipulations? Are we not called heirs of a royal priesthood? Then why don't we take better care of the temples that are in our hearts, that house the very presence of God himself? It's because we've let that go to ruins. It's why many Christians are falling away from the faith today. It is why people are the world is in chaos. 1 Corinthians 6:19, it's not going to be up on the screen, it says it plainly. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. Your bodies, your hearts have been purchased at an incredibly high price. It took the price of the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to atone and cleanse us so that his Spirit can live in us through power and might. And it strikes me that if we have the Holy Spirit in us, why were we so quick to fear everything that was going on in the world today? This is not new. Is God affected by this virus or by this pandemic? Is he affected by anything that happens in the world? We're like a speck to him. Is he affected by this? In Paul's writing to Timothy, he says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but one of power, of love, and of a sound mind. The purpose of that verse was to be applied in situations like this, but it's the last thing that we look to. We look to everything else to give us security, but we need to turn to our Lord who lives within our hearts. Do you not know, church, that this world is going into hell in a handbasket? It's stipulated in Scripture. But for we who put our faith upon Jesus Christ, who put our faith upon the Son of God, we can rest assured that the God who is in control of all things, He said that He will take care of us. He looks after His own. So I say to you, banish Satan and his thieves from your temple. Get these out of here. Stop turning my Father's house into a market. Don't let the enemy take up root in your temple. Don't let his minions take root and start selling things from the marketplace of your temple. That is holy ground. And you must not give the enemy no quarter, any quarter, in your temple. What I believe is that what we're seeing today is a fulfillment of prophecy. In the book of Haggai, chapter 1, verse 9, it says, "You expected much, but see, it turned out to be little. What you brought home, I blew away. Why, declares the Lord Almighty, because of my house, which remains a ruin, while each of you is busy with his own house." You know, when I think about Solomon, and I think about the people of Israel who were gathered with him at the dedication of the temple that he had built to his Lord, you know, I imagine, I think about the manifestation of the Lord's presence. The glory of the Lord so filled the temple that the priests couldn't even perform their duties. And I'm thinking, this is before Jesus' salvation came into play. This is before there was ever grace or mercy. People still lived under the authority of the law, and as Paul said, the law, it brings death. Because it condemns us. The law condemns us on its face. And yet, in that situation, the glory of the Lord manifested itself totally. And yet, you know, there are many who limit the power of God to the Old Testament. There are many people who say that the Holy Spirit is not active. Let me tell you something. The Holy Spirit is much more active. Jesus said that you will do greater things. So where are the greater things? Where are the greater things of faith? You know, me and my dad, we're talking at the beginning of this pandemic, we would converse and say that, you know, now is an opportunity for the church at large to stand up and to be a light amidst the darkness for everything that is going on. Where are we? Where is the church today? We're supposed to be the light of the world, but yet we put it underneath a basket. I'll tell you what. I have no faith in this world. I have no faith in anything that it offers. I have no faith in the institutions that we put our trust in. I have no faith in any of it. All of it came crashing down, and all it took was a little virus to destroy everything. People are tearing their hair out, bombarding, killing people in the marketplace. It's you know, Scripture says that we would be enduring things like this. And you know, for someone like me who likes to think rationally, I like to think that, you know, okay, there's probably some part of this that is under my control. None of this was under my control. And naturally, as a person I am, I would be terrified. My anxiety would be through the roof. I would be petrified of what is going on. But amazingly, the Lord instilled me with such a peace. And in that time, in those moments where I got my head together and then I finally entered into my time with the Lord, He revealed to me that you are in my hands. You are in my hands. My spirit lives in you. The Bible says in Psalm 27, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Of whom shall I fear? Of whom shall I be afraid? What can man do to me?" Since why would we have known that? Why do we think that portion of Scripture is no longer valid today when it really matters? Is it just something that we just say off the cuff? Or is it something that we really believe? That when time tests us, when the crucible for silver and the furnace for gold, the Lord tests the heart. Why did we learn to put our faith in Christ when it really mattered as a people? And the third point I'll leave with you. Tim, if you come. Only the violent will fight the good fight and finish the race. You know, There's a reason why God says that in these times there will only be a remnant, because only a few will ever storm heaven with the prayers that are needed to change lives. Only a few. You know, though, the enemy does everything he can to silence his people through discouragement, through fear, through sorrow, through grief, anger, rage, guilt, condemnation. The enemy throws all of that. And he's throwing it out even more so now because he knows his time is short. Shorter now than it was yesterday. Shorter now than it was the year before. So he's going to get more aggressive. And in the same way that the enemy chooses to get more aggressive because he's scared out of his mind, we must be just as aggressive to claim souls for the kingdom of God. Amen. And let me tell you something, church. None of it can be accomplished without those who violently pray and storm heaven's gates. Amen. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. You know why? It says in scripture that wide is the road and broad is the way that leads to destruction. Many there be that find it, but narrow is the way. Narrow is the way, and small is the road that leads to life, and few there be that find it. Because think about it. If the enemy is coming up against you with all of these things that are designed to destroy you, what do you have to do? You gotta claw for the kingdom of God. You gotta fight back in prayer. And the enemy comes against you, you push, and you push, and you push back. I am a child of God. I am not a victim. I am not a victim of the enemy's schemes. I am not a victim. It is he who is condemned, not me. The Bible says I'm going from faith to faith and from glory to glory. I have a kingdom that is waiting for me. I have the promise of eternal kingdom of the Lord. I have that. The enemy cannot steal it from you if you will learn. If the Holy Spirit is ignited within you, what can the enemy do? This is not to say that we should be boastful in our strength, because we can't. We're very weak. And the enemy knows that. The enemy is very cunning in the way that he deceives his people and destroys us. We respect the fact that he can deceive us. He knows the word of God better than we do. But we have one who is greater than the one that is in the world. We don't have to rely upon our own strength. It is not dependent upon us. It is dependent only upon the God who lives in us. We don't live like a condemned people. We don't live like a passive people. The dynamic of what we believe as followers of Christ was displayed as early as the book of Genesis.
Not as good.
In Genesis chapter 32, verses 24 to 28. Then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. The breaking of day. I think of that in our terms when Jesus comes back. A man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, "Let me go, for the day breaks." But he said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" He said, "Jacob." And he said, "Your name shall no longer be Jacob, but Israel, for you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed." This is before grace, let me remind you. This is before Jesus even came into the picture. Jacob didn't have the Holy Spirit to rely on. He didn't live in it. But yet Jacob prevailed. Because he loved his God. He loved him so much that even when the Lord tested him and said, "Let me go," Jacob said, "No, I'm going to hold on to you until you bless me." In the same way, church, we as the people of God must cling to our Lord with everything that we have until the day that he breaks through the clouds, the day breaks, and we see our King descending in glory, and then the battle is over. 1 Corinthians 9:27. This is Paul speaking. "No, I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified. I will violently strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize." Violent faith. The gospel that we believe is not a rainbow gospel, and I'm using that term loosely. It's not a superficial gospel. It's a sacrificial gospel. It's a gory gospel. It's a bloody gospel. And Paul recognized this. He recognized the price that was paid for him because he knew the track record of his sin. Which is why he humbled himself always and said, no, my flesh will not prevail. The enemy will not prevail. The enemy will not get me to sin against my Lord. I will strike a blow to my body. And this doesn't mean physical violence, church. Let me clarify that right now. It is the crucifixion of your flesh daily before the Lord, and that can only be done through prayer. Lord, less of me, more of you. Less of me, more of you. I can't live this life. I can't endure what's being thrown at me. The world has nothing to go on with this pandemic. Everyone is tearing their hair out. They're coming out with this theory and that theory and this theory. So will we open by 2021? Will we open by 2022? Master effective, master ineffective. Let me tell you something. The only thing that we have that we know that will never change is our faith in the Lord Jesus. That's it. And now we should be clinging to that greater than ever before. Jesus himself displayed how his followers must fight before the day of judgment. Jesus prayed this way in the Garden of Gethsemane right before the day of judgment when he was about to be crucified. Luke chapter 22, verse 44. He prayed more fervently and he was in such agony of spirit that his sweat fell to the ground like great drops of blood. The last remnant is called remnant because only a few will ever assault the kingdom of God with such prayers to claim their prize with such violence and spirit. The enemy cannot endure the terror of the people of God igniting their temples in prayer against him and his armies. The enemy is powerless when we ignite the Holy Spirit that lives in us. He will never succeed. He has already lost, church. That cross right there stands as a symbol of his everlasting defeat. Jesus already paid the price, a dear price, in the day before his judgment, before God, because Jesus took upon our judgment. He prayed fervently to the point that blood dropped from his hand. That's our Lord giving us this example. Think about that. Because Jesus was attached to the flesh, so he endured every temptation that we did, and which is why Jesus came to the point and said, Father, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me. He was wrestling with himself, with his spirit. He was wrestling with it. But he said, but not my will, but yours be done. Do you think he would have been able to come to that conclusion if he didn't pray violently in that garden? Jesus was illustrating how his people must live. The enemy cannot endure the prayers of his people, which is why he silences us. Which is why he quiets our voices. Which is why he quieted my voice. Because the enemy fears nothing more than when the people of God recognize that they are indeed the people of God. No one can take away what has been given to you as a free gift. The enemy only has as much power as you let him. Jesus claimed his prize by violently redeeming the world of sin through his crucifixion. We claim our prize by claiming his coming reign through violently crucifying our flesh and purifying our temples daily to Christ until the day when all will see him crowned with glory and honor as King.
Amen.
Let me tell you something, church. The hour is getting short. I don't know how else to cut it. But amazingly, for someone who struggles with fear, who struggles with fear as a natural person, who struggles with a thing, you know, because I know you live in me. I think the pandemic, what it did, personally, is that it sifted us, sifted the people of God, and that those who remained were the ones who were willing to go to the ground in prayer for the sake of their faith. Those who were willing to go to their grave praising the name of Jesus. Jesus is now looking for those who will violently, violently defend their temples, as he did. Amen. No more, church. The time for idleness, the time for the superficial stuff, that's gone. That's over. That has been canceled, and the pandemic proved it. The power that the early church had, the upper room, Pentecost, that the disciples had, all of that is available to us. We just need to call upon the name of the Lord, and he'll do it. That's his promise. The Bible says that even before they asked me, I'll answer them. That's how zealous he is for his people. We must be zealous for what we believe as followers of Christ. The enemy is coming with all of his armies, and there is no mercy stand on the seashore. But we have a God who overcame it all. And he is the one who we serve. And he alone is our king. So what can man do to us? What can the enemy do to us? We are a saved people. We are a redeemed people. We are a righteous people by the blood of the Lamb. We are a strong people, not by our own merit, but by the King that lives within us. If you're weak, if you're tired, if you're exhausted, let me tell you something. And from the book of Isaiah, those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They will mount up on the wings of eagles. They shall walk and not grow weary. They shall run and not grow faint. Now is the time, church. Now is the time to wait upon the power of your God. Now! The world is crying out for a Savior. We can present him to the world. We can present him here. I will show you salvation. His name is Jesus Christ. I will show you peace. His name is Jesus Christ. I will show you the only God that ever existed in the history of the world and the universe. His name is Jesus Christ. I will show you the author and the perfecter of my faith. His name is Jesus Christ. I will show you the rock of my salvation. His name is Jesus Christ. I will show you the Word. His name is Jesus Christ. I will show you the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. His name is Jesus Christ. His name is Emmanuel.
Pray. The Lord has had to bend my knees
And when I enter into his presence, everything else fades away. Everything that is going on in the world fades away. All of it. All the fear, all the anxiety, all the destruction, all the chaos, all of it fades away. Because in the Lord's presence, I am standing on holy ground. What better place is there to be than on holy ground? When Moses was before his God, what else did he need? When Elijah stood before his God, what else did he need? Let us stand on holy ground and let us never leave. Holy ground lives within us, church. Holy ground lives within us. Brothers and sisters, holy ground lives in your heart. Holy ground, because the Holy Spirit lives there. Brothers and sisters, to my left, your heart has holy ground because the Holy Spirit lives there. Pastor Joey, your heart has holy ground because the Holy Spirit lives there. For those who are watching online, your heart is holy ground because the Holy Spirit lives there. For all who believe, and that is our security. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Father God, we thank you, Jesus, for always being faithful, Lord God, when we are faithless, Lord. Oh, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, we approach your throne humble, Lord God, because we know, Lord Jesus, that when we should have relied on you, we relied upon this world, we relied upon our own understanding, we did not trust. But Jesus, even though we have been faithless, Lord God, you have been so faithful. Lord Jesus, you were the strength, Lord God, that filled up our weakness, Lord God. You taught us the meaning, Lord God, of relying, Lord Jesus, upon your strength, because your strength is made perfect in weakness, Lord. Lord Jesus, you have such a zeal, Lord God, for your people and for your house, Lord Jesus. I pray, God, that right now, in this very moment, Lord God, that you will ignite the temples, Lord God, of your people. That you will set your Holy Spirit ablaze, Lord God, in the hearts of those who call upon your name, who dare to call upon the name of Jesus, who are willing to call upon that name and not be ashamed. Lord God, may you ignite their hearts, Lord Jesus, with the Holy Spirit, Lord God. Let them know, Lord Jesus, that there is nothing to fear, Lord God. Lord Jesus, I pray, God, that you will ignite us, Lord God, with such zeal, Lord God. Lord Jesus, that we, Lord God, will always, Lord Jesus, from day in and day out, from this day forward, realize, Lord God, that we need to approach you, Lord God. We need to violently, Lord God, do war in the Spirit, Lord God. For the kingdom of heaven only belongs to those who are violently willing to claim it, Lord Jesus. That was the meaning, Lord God. So I pray, God, that you will ignite us, Lord Jesus, as you assemble, Lord God, your army, Lord God. Oh, Lord Jesus, as the days get more dark, Lord God, and though we fall, Lord Jesus, we remember scripture, Lord God, which says, don't gloat over me, my enemy. Though I have fallen, I will rise, and though I sit in darkness, the Lord will be my light. Jesus, we trust in you and you alone, Lord God. And we pray, God, that you, Lord Jesus, will set our hearts ablaze with your Spirit, Lord God. That we will learn to do warfare in the faith, Lord God. That we will learn, Lord Jesus, to put our faith only in you, Lord God. That we will learn to turn our eyes towards the hills from whence doth come our help. Our help comes from the Lord. Lord Jesus, we want to finish this fight. We want to finish this race. Help us to have the strength to run it and to win it, Lord God. The time, Lord Jesus, for the superficial faith, Lord God, that was foreign to what you taught, Lord God, all of that is gone, Lord Jesus. All that remains, Lord God, is the faithful, those who dare to believe. When all else seems lost, Lord God, the people of God are going to rise and they're going to proclaim your name like never before. I declare the enemy has not won. The enemy has not won. For we have Emmanuel standing guard, Lord God. We hide ourselves behind the foot of the cross, Lord Jesus. Of that blessed old wooden cross, Lord Jesus. That establishes, Lord God, our salvation from now into eternity, Lord Jesus. We will violently fight in the Spirit, Lord God. We will see your name glorified. We will see your name glorified above the earth, Lord God. Lord Jesus, for you, Lord God, are a mighty God. And we are more than conquerors, Lord God. So with the same zeal that you use to cleanse out sin from your temple, Lord God, we, Lord Jesus, the bearers, Lord God, of the temple of God, we too cleanse it out, Lord God. And we say to the enemy, get out. We tell the enemy, get out. You will not corrupt my Father's house any longer. Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. We turn our eyes upon Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you so much, Lord God. We need you like never before, Lord God. Oh, Heavenly Father, we need you like never before.
Because we are a weak people. But you are strong, and the same glory that you used to show your might to your people, Lord God. The same glory, Lord Jesus, that revealed itself when Moses stood before the Red Sea and said, stand back and see the salvation of the Lord. That same glory, Lord God, is alive today, Lord Jesus. So, Lord God, we disband with all of the things, all of the dreck, all of the garbage, Lord God, that is going on in the world. You said in your word that these things will happen. But Lord Jesus, we say to you, Lord God, in the presence of witnesses, Lord God, that when all have faded away, we, Lord Jesus, will turn our eyes towards you from now and for all eternity. We are yours, Lord Jesus. For those who do not know of this Savior whom I speak, let me tell you something. As someone who studied the books, because that's who I am, there is no greater answer to this world and everything that is going on in it than the Savior that I serve. So make that decision today. If that is you, whether you're here in this sanctuary, or whether you are sitting at home online watching this, proclaim that Jesus is Lord. Proclaim that he is your Savior. And get ready for the most amazing journey of your life. I tell you that as someone who's been through much, but I am so joyful that I know my Lord and I love him now more than ever before. Jesus, we love you, and we ask all of these things in your name. Amen. To close out, I've asked my brother to lead us in a song. If you need to be renewed in your strength, if you need to be renewed, if your spirit needs to be renewed, if you want to do war now, if you want to be violent in your faith, if you want to be violent, if you want to be something that the enemy fears because the Lord God is with you, if you feel that you're lacking and you feel that you're weak, I'm going to ask everyone to stand up. But if for those who want renewal, I want to ask you to just step out into the aisles of your seats. We're trying to still social distance. But we're going to sing this song, Let Us Wait Upon the Lord. Because he's the only one that's going to be able to renew your strength. I can't. None of us can, but the Lord who lives in you can.
So I'm going to ask everyone to stand up in the congregation. And if you need that renewal, just step aside into the aisle. The Lord sees you. And we're going to sing this song, and I want you to sing it with joy. Sing it with power. Sing it with zeal. We're going to see the Lord do great things. Amen.
Come on, let's wait upon the Lord. He will renew our strength. If we just wait upon the Lord, He will renew our strength. And come on, let's wait.
Christ, sing to our Lord. Hallelujah.
Come on, let's wait upon
the Lord. People of God, raise your voice to our Lord.
He will renew our strength. If we just wait upon the Lord, He will renew.
Some prayer requests there. If you can just give them out quickly. Very sobering message from the Lord tonight. How many are going to dig in into your faith, in Christ? Amen. By the fact that you're here on a Tuesday night, many of you worked all day and you're here, that tells me that you are ready to do some battle. Amen? We need to enlist some more people. But let me tell you, it's always a remnant that God uses to win the battle and the victory. It's not a numbers game with God. It's a heart situation. If your heart is fervent for the Lord, what he can do with one person who's fervent for God, oh my goodness gracious. And there's many of us here that love the Lord and are waiting on God. Amen. We're going to take a few minutes to pray for these needs. Those of you that don't have a prayer request, lift up the church, Deep Waters Tabernacle. We always want to only follow what the Lord is calling us to do. We want direction. We need the Lord to help us. We want to grow in maturity and in the faith. We want people to learn to love Jesus with all their hearts. And we're coming obviously into a new and different opposition against a lot of things that that the church stands for. But like my son said, we're not shrinking back. We're not shrinking back. We have the power of Almighty God with us. How many say amen? Amen. Those of you that have a prayer request, lift it up right now. Those of you that don't, lift up the direction of the church. Ask God to just, I want him to pour out his power and his Holy Spirit. Amen. And by the way, not just here, yes, here, we're here, but everywhere that's calling upon the name of Jesus, every place in Frederick County, in Montgomery County, in Carroll County, in Howard County, in PG County, everywhere in across the nation and our world where there is a church praying and calling out to God that God would pour out his Spirit and his power in these last days. Amen. We have our prayer call. Those of you that don't have a card, pray for that. Those of you that have a card, concentrate on that person. And let's call on the Lord for a few moments, and then I'll close this out. Yeah. Hallelujah. Thank you for hearing us, Lord God. Thank you for these prayer requests, oh God, that we had the privilege just now of lifting up to you, Father. I know you've heard every single one of them, Lord God. And Lord, because you are a faithful God, and because, Lord, your love for us is amazing, Lord, I know, Father, that you're going to move, Lord God, according to what we've prayed, oh God, in agreement with those that, Lord God, wrote these requests on this card, on these cards, oh God. We just, Lord God, thank you, Father, for hearing us. And Lord, I pray for every other need represented right now here in this building and those that are watching online, oh God. I'm so thankful, oh God, that you don't, as we're praying for others, you don't forget our needs, oh God. Father, I lift up every situation, every circumstance, every illness, oh Lord God, every needed resource, oh God, every supply that's needed, oh God, we turn it over to you, Father, because you are the source of everything for us, oh God. Even the breath in our lungs, oh God, comes from you. We recognize that, God, and we're glad about it because you're a good God. You're a good God, and your mercies endure forever, Lord. Help us, O God, as we seek you with all of our heart, O God, and as we worship you and continue to worship you in spirit and in truth. Move among us in greater ways, O Lord God. We're looking to you for more, and we thank you, Lord God, for what's ahead. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Church, let's go forward. Strong in our faith. There's nothing else that's going to remain. Amen. We're going to see God do something among us. We're here to see God do something. I'm so glad that we're not here just to form little clubs or have a nice little time. There's no time for that. We're going to have a great time, but it's by seeing God move by his power. Amen. Let's go forward and not give up territory, but claim territory, new territory for Christ, starting in our hearts and beyond, out there where so many people need the Lord Jesus. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you for coming tonight. Be blessed. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be with you wherever you go, leading you and guiding you and guarding you from behind and surrounding himself. We're surrounding you with his presence. May the Lord bless you. Thank you for coming tonight. Those of you that want to linger for a little while, you're welcome to do that and pray. Amen.